Hi, everyone, and welcome to Dechert's Labor and Employment Group podcast on COVID-19. My name is Tom Johnson, and with me today in London are Emma Zarb, in Paris is Philippe Thomas, and in Munich, Germany is Giovanni Russo. And today we're talking to you a little bit about to test or not to test. One of the questions that has come up for many of our clients as they consider returning to work after government restrictions are lifted. And the testing comes in a number of forms, and we thought it would be helpful to talk through with you some of the issues that we see across the globe developing as employers develop their return to work policies. Should employers test or make return to work conditional on testing? I think there are three core questions that all employers need to consider. The first is the test accurate and reliable? And that is a standard that is embedded in U.S. law, but I think has equal application, as you'll hear, around the globe. Who will administer the test? Is that person qualified? And who will pay? And we'll focus a little less on that, but here in the United States, where testing has become a center of many return to work efforts, there are issues related to non-exempt employees and how they will be compensated if testing takes time in their workday. The first kind of testing we want to talk about is temperature testing or temperature screening. This has become popular. We see it here in the United States, all over the place. The EEOC issued guidelines recently suggesting that it was fine for employers to test employees for temperature, in particular for fevers, although it was not specific as to what fever means. Various state regulations and guidance have also said the same thing. The White House return to work plan has suggested employers should be testing employee temperatures to determine whether or not they should return to work, obviously because in many cases COVID-19 has as one of its symptoms a fever. The specific fever is a little bit of a question as to what you're screening for, but most seem to be centered around 100, 100.4 degrees Fahrenheit, which is roughly 38 degrees Celsius. And, you know, in the United States, I think that this is common and accepted, and I think that it is forming a key part of many plans that we see employers developing. But I don't think that's the case around the world. Philippe, you were talking a little bit earlier when we spoke about France and some developments there that make it very unlikely that a French employer would ever use temperature screening. Why don't you tell us a little bit about that?
Yes, indeed, Tom. So for France, the situation is such that the French government issued a protocol for the return to work. And in this protocol, the government advises against temperature checks. It doesn't mean that employers cannot do it. They can organize it, but they will have to follow a specific process whereby they will issue an internal notice which will amount to a new disciplinary rule. In such a scenario, if an employee refuses to undergo the check, the employer may send him home, but in that case, the employer will have to continue to pay this employee his normal salary.
Well, Philippe, it sounds like temperature testing hasn't caught on. Is that fair to say in France?
That's right. That's exactly right.
Okay. And Emma, how about in London? What are you hearing there as you look ahead for employers who are thinking about returning to work? Do you see people asking about temperature screening?
Well, as you point out, Tom, there's currently no real detail about how reliable temperature is, and some people don't necessarily show symptoms of coronavirus at all, let alone have a high temperature. So currently our government guidance doesn't require any mandatory temperature checks. But the big concern, and without turning this into a data protection webinar, the big concern from a UK and for a lot of Europe relates to our data protection laws, because the taking of someone's temperature is considered data on a person's health. And this is special category data under the GDPR. So for the employer to take the temperature and to record that temperature, they need to have a lawful basis for processing it. And in this case, that's quite easy. I think an employer can say, I've got a legitimate interest in taking a person's temperature, that legitimate interest being it's necessary to ensure the health and safety of our workers and to provide a safe working environment. But they also need to satisfy a condition under Article 9 of the GDPR. And that's where it becomes a bit more difficult, because it's difficult to rely on consent. And so they'll therefore have to rely on it being necessary to comply with their legal obligations towards the health and safety of their employees. And because government guidance aren't recommending temperature checks, it can be difficult to say that this is a necessary measure to take people's temperatures. In addition to GDPR and data protection issues, we've also got issues of medical consent. So if you do want to take employees' temperatures, you need a special medical consent form. One way to get around this is perhaps not to process data and to just have employees walking through a temperature screening process and asking them not to attend the office if they fail or go beyond a certain temperature and sort of set off the alarms. But obviously you still need to think about, well, what do you do when the temperature alarm goes off? How is that recorded anywhere, the fact that the employee has set the alarm off? And because of these data protection and medical consent concerns, what we're finding in the UK is a more cautious approach is just to ask employees to self-certify. So to confirm that if they're coming to the office as a condition of coming back, they don't have a temperature or they're not showing other symptoms of coronavirus.
Right. And I think we'll talk a little bit later about self-certification as a possible alternative to some of the more invasive testing. Giovanni, is Germany about the same as the UK, given that GDPR is across Europe? Any special guidance there concerning the taking of temperatures?
No, I think in Germany, we can say that we have a similar approach as Emma just described for the UK. So, you know, as we are now in Germany gradually easing the lockdown restrictions, employees are required to return to work, and employers understandably wish to take appropriate precautions against the virus. And one of the questions frequently asked to us is whether, you know, temperature testing works. And this question is actually partly controversially discussed. But in the meanwhile, we have certain data protection authorities that gave guidance in that respect, saying that they don't see that temperature testing, and I think you described it in the US as well, is, you know, probably not an appropriate means to determine whether someone is infected or not. And it is definitely a collection of personal data that, from a data protection perspective, is concerning, is legally concerning. So unless, you know, but what is being done frequently in the meanwhile is that employers ask the employee at the entrance of the site to do the temperature testing just on a daily basis to decide whether the employees can access the site or not. But we have the same issues as Emma just described for the UK. So do you collect the data in case they are, you know, they have temperature and have to go home again? Obviously, if you would record that or collect the data, we would again have a violation of GDPR. So it's not an easy situation for employers here.
Right, and I think that obviously, I think what you're saying is that in Germany, again, not only are the privacy issues paramount, but also the issue of accuracy and the limits of this test. And I think Emma's talked about that as well as you, and I think people are right. Although a temperature seems like an easy thing to measure, I'm not sure it is always accurately and reliably measured, but I think in the United States, people accept it as such, and in lieu of any better test, I think that a lot of people are moving towards it. Certainly government authorities are. The next kind of testing I want to sort of focus on a little bit in the discussion is testing for active infections, a diagnostic test for COVID-19, and antibody or serology testing to test for exposure to the virus in the past. And this has gotten a lot of attention in the United States. for a number of reasons. First of all, the EEOC has in fact actually approved the use of testing for an active infection, a diagnostic test, that employers may use that to determine whether or not an employee may return to work. But of course, over all of this are questions about accuracy and reliability and who administers these tests. And there is, in fact, in many places, a shortage of tests to be had. So actually implementing this has practical issues associated with it. That second kind of test, the antibody test, is sort of one step further removed than the actual diagnostic or active infection test. The tests are generally, at the moment at least, believed to be less reliable, and the EEOC has not said anything about their use, and so therefore it's presumed that they are not permitted under disability law in the United States. But that certainly could change in time. I think the hope is that antibodies would enable people to conclude that the individual was able to return to work and would be immune from infection. But again, so far the science isn't there yet, and therefore employers are not advised to use it. Philippe, in France, it sounds like given the May guidance, it doesn't sound like testing really of any kind is going to be permitted, whether for an active infection or for antibodies.
That's absolutely right. I mean, the French government has taken a very firm position against mass testing, and it is absolutely forbidden to conduct them. On the other hand, I mean, some employers may consider testing employees on a voluntary basis, and it should actually take place outside the work premises. But what really matters at the moment is that employers offer a safe environment, and employers are actually doing everything they can to offer this safe environment. Unfortunately, these tests will not be considered in France as an effective measure to offer a safe work environment.
And Emma, again, I think what we're hearing from you are the privacy concerns in the UK, at least at this stage. It doesn't sound like UK employers are really considering either testing for active infections or antibodies as part of their return to work plans. Does that sound right? Am I right?
Well, yes. I mean, testing at the moment for coronavirus is only available to essential workers. So people working in the health service, people working in food distribution and manufacturing, that sort of environment, or for anyone who can't work from home, or for any family members who work with an essential worker or someone who can't work from home. So it's quite limited. But even when it becomes more widely available for the GDPR and medical consent concerns that I've previously outlined, I'm not sure if it will become a thing or indeed a way forward for employers. It's much better to ask people, I think, to self-certify and to not show up to the office if they've got symptoms. And with the antibody tests, I think it's too early to say, as you pointed out, Tom. At the moment, they're fairly unreliable. So again, we have no government guidance and no testing available at the moment in that regard.
Thanks, Emma. Giovanni, how about in Germany? Are you seeing any employers asking about testing for active infection or for the antibodies, for that matter?
Well, I have not seen any requests for antibody testing, but we have had clients asking for infection testing in Germany. However, although we have, you know, it's untested law and we have no real guidance by the German authorities, it is rather unlikely that this would be considered legal without the employee's voluntary consent. And the consent would only be considered voluntary if the denial of the consent is not linked to any disadvantage. So accordingly, an employer cannot really sanction an employee who refused to get medically tested. Obviously, the situation can be different if the employer has a compelling suspicion in an individual case that the employee is infected. In such case, what would be legal is that the employer asks the employee to go to a doctor and to have the doctor confirm that the employee is fit for the job. So the doctor cannot confirm whether the person has actually coronavirus or not, but whether the person has is fit for the job. And you know, and if the that is a kind of testing that would be suitable in case the employer has a compelling suspicion that the employee is not fit for the work because of the virus.
Right. I think that in the U.S., you certainly could ask for return to work notes, but I think recent guidance is sensitive to the fact that it may be difficult for employees to actually get to doctors to even provide a return to work note, given how busy healthcare workers are at the moment. And I think that some folks, as you say, are perhaps viewing the testing for at least active infections as part of a two-part process where either the temperature screening is triggered or other symptoms are revealed, and then and only then would they proceed to the, you know, actually proceeding with a test for the particular individual. Certainly, given the shortage of tests, that might be a practical way to proceed in the United States. But, you know, I think that overall what I'm hearing is that testing, at least for temperature screening, seems to be a bigger thing in the United States than it is in France or UK or in Germany. But we'll have to wait and see, I guess, to see how things develop. And certainly testing for active infections isn't quite there yet because we all face the same practical difficulties related to them. And then, of course, in the EU, we have particular privacy concerns to be worried about and what you do with that data. Here in the U.S., fortunately, we don't have GDPR. I guess that's fortunate. But we do have the ADA, which I think most employers are familiar with, and the EEOC has said, for instance, that temperature data, testing data, has to be treated as confidential health information and should be kept in separate files. And employers should be careful in the U.S. When they gather this information, even though there is no GDPR, about what they do with it, how they share it with third parties, and to be careful if they decide they're going to use third parties to conduct any of this screening. I want to return just to a topic that Emma raised earlier, which is employee self-certifications. We see a lot of people asking about these. They're very popular. They're relatively easy, but I think they run the gamut from what I would describe as the haiku certification to a mini novella that requires the employee to reveal an awful lot about themselves. Most that I have seen are limited to questions related to exposure to infected individuals or likely infected individuals, travel to high-risk areas, and specific questions about symptoms that are currently associated with infection of COVID-19. And they're provided to employees before they return to work. They complete them and they're told to update them and update the employer if they, in fact, anything on them changes. And the people have been handing them out, certainly in some essential businesses I've seen them handed out who are currently operating in the United States. How about in France? Would employee certifications work? Have you seen those? Have you seen people trying to use them? Philippe, what's your sense of where people are in terms of return to work and self-certification?
No, Tom, we don't see them at the moment, and there are two reasons for that. One is that we are very careful and protective of privacy, and the second is, which is probably more important, which is that medical information cannot be collected by the employer. If any kind of questionnaire needs to be filled in, then it has to be done under the supervision or in coordination with the company medical doctor. So in no circumstances, the employer could actually collect this kind of information.
Thanks, Philippe. Emma, I think you were telling me that you were dealing recently with a US-based employer who has employees in the UK, and that they presented you with what I guess is one of the longer forms for employees to self-certify in connection with COVID. Why don't you tell us a little bit about your experience with that?
Yeah, sure. I think as you've pointed out, Tom, throughout this podcast, that in the US, perhaps asking questions is more common. And so it's not surprising that our US clients are perhaps more interested in questionnaires and self-certification than our EU clients. But ultimately, it comes down to the GDPR again and data minimization. So even if you're not asking questions about the employee's health, you still shouldn't have more information than you need on an employee. So for that reason, although you are permitted, and again, it's got to be in line with government guidance, to ask questions to ensure your workplace is secure, such as where people have been travelling, if they show symptoms of coronavirus, etc. There's currently, as you say, no, you know, it's only current on the day it's given. And so rather than a self-certification, in the UK, to avoid these issues, we tend to prefer that people report on an as and when basis. So we generally recommend that rather than a questionnaire, offices give a list of guidelines and requirements for the return to work, and they ask employees to sort of certify by reporting if they do show any symptoms or if they have not complied with any of the conditions for return to work on a need-to-know basis. But you don't ask for it from the outset so that you don't have a lot of data on the individuals.
That certainly seems like a good idea, to give people clear instructions and to have them self-report in connection with that policy if they raise one of the issues related to a symptom, including temperature or otherwise. Giovanni, in Germany, I understand questionnaires are used, but they are mostly limited to three magic questions. Why don't you tell our audience a little bit about those and what you've seen?
Yeah. So information about employees' health, and such as whether the individual has been diagnosed with a virus or is suffering from any symptoms, is, you know, as in UK and France, sensitive personal data, and the position is also complex from a German data privacy perspective, as we are all based on the, you know, GDPR. So far, there is no precedent in Germany, in German law, but it is the prevailing opinion and even a recommendation from various data protection authorities in certain states in Germany, that the employer's obligation to ensure health and safety of its entire workforce prevails over the individual interest to protect its personal data. So that in such cases, employees are obliged to provide information about any infection to avoid further spread of the infection amongst the workforce. Hence, employers may ask their employees about their symptoms and their health status as far as it is relevant in connection with the protection of the workforce or even the customers against the coronavirus. The same applies for information about whether the employee has had contact with a person knowingly having had the virus in the recent past. So that's the two information that you can ask about you know, the health and you know, connection with people who might have had or have had the virus. And the third question you can ask is whether an employer has traveled into risk territories as defined by the German Robert Koch Institute, as those areas where infection rates were particularly high. So these three questions, and you can keep that as an ongoing obligation during the employment relationship, at least for so long as the virus is around, that the employees are required to inform the employer about any change in the situation.
I think that sounds sensible, and sounds similar to the approach in the United States in terms of asking questions, although, again, the German questions may be more limited, it seems, than what I see some U.S. employers asking on the self-certification. Well, I want to thank everyone for joining us on our podcast today concerning labor and employment issues and COVID-19 and specifically testing. Please join us for our next podcast, which will continue this discussion with our global employment lawyers, and when we will focus on the issue of what happens when the test comes back positive, how to exclude workers from the workplace, how to develop an appropriate policy for that, and what to do with employees who will not return to work. Thank you very much for joining us.